From the Library of Congress in Washington, D.C.
Hi, everyone. Welcome to the beautiful Woodall Pavilion. Thanks for coming out. My name is Rob Casper. I'm the head of the Poetry and Literature Center. And I'm delighted to welcome you to the first of our Making the Case series with the National Book Critics Circle. Before we begin, I'm going to do something I ask you to do it too, which is to turn off your phones and other electronic devices that may interfere with the recording of this event. I also want to let you know that there'll be a question and answer period as part of this event. And if you choose to participate in the question and answer period, you let us use your response for possible webcasts of this event and podcasts. Let me also tell you a little bit about the Poetry and Literature Center, which is hosting this event. We are home to the Poet Laureate, Consultant in Poetry, and we put on a range of readings, lectures, symposia throughout the year. We're thrilled to have you here. If you want to find out more about the events that we have, you can sign our sign-up sheet, which is just out there in the foyer. And there's some materials that tell you a little bit more about the Poetry and Literature Center, too. You can visit us also online at www.loc.gov/poetry. Most of you should all have programs, and with your programs, you should also have a survey. We're trying to figure out how to serve our audiences more effectively, so we'd really appreciate you filling out that survey. And you can hand it back to me. You can also hand it back to Anya Crichton, who's right here, or in the back, Matt Blakely. Matt, want to raise your hand? So please do fill those out and say hi to our staff. The mission of the Poetry and Literature Center is to, quote, foster and enhance the public's appreciation of literature, end quote. And I can't imagine a better partner in that work than the National Book Critics Circle. The NBCC honors outstanding writing and fosters a national conversation about reading, criticism, and literature. The National Book Critics Circle Awards are given each March and honor the best literature published in the United States in six categories: autobiography, biography, criticism, fiction, nonfiction, and last but not least, poetry. These are the only national literary awards chosen by critics themselves. To find out more about the organization, you can visit bookcritics.org online. We are honored to have Stephen Burt here today to launch this series with a lecture titled, "The Poem Is You." You can read more about Stephen in your print program. But let me just say that when I think of critics championing literature to the general public who have shaped and continue to shape my understanding of the art, I think of our featured speaker. My first encounter with Stephen's criticism was his essay, The Elliptical Poets, which I discovered while browsing through lip mags at Out of Town News, the famous magazine stand in the middle of Harvard Square. And if any of you have been there, it's a mecca for magazines. This essay was a game changer for many in my generation, and no one can talk about what's happened in contemporary American poetry in the last three decades without mentioning it. Since that fateful moment in my life, I have followed Stephen's writings on poets of all stripes, much of which was captured in his book, Close Calls with Nonsense, Reading New Poetry. And that book, along with Stephen's most recent book of poetry, is for sale outside, and hopefully you'll buy a copy afterwards and get him to sign it. One chapter focuses on Juan Felipe Herrera and was originally printed in the New York Times under the title Half Punk Panther. This was the sole review I presented to the Librarian of Congress when he was considering Herrera as our next poet laureate. And I like to believe that Stephen's engaging, insightful writing helped, quote, seal the deal. Reporting the laureate announcement, the New York Times turned again to Stephen, who said Juan Felipe was, quote, always trying to get outside what he's already done, line by line, poem by poem, book by book. He's really unpredictable in the best possible way, end quote. The same is true of Stephen's critical eye, which is constantly looking for new and essential work. It's also true that, like Juan Felipe, Stephen aims to speak to us all in ways that instruct and delight us and ultimately make us more fulfilled human beings. Please join me in welcoming Stephen Burt.
I hope I can measure up to some of that. It's an honor to be here. I should remind you also, if you want to know more about the National Book Critics Circle, which is an organization to which I owe a lot in a couple different ways, bookcritics.org is the place to go. And if you write reviews yourself, even if you've just started writing reviews, you might want to think about joining. So this is about a 40-plus minute talk about the next critical project, the one that I'm now finishing up and should actually be sending, a publisher sitting on a draft of it, but should be finishing up in one way or another over the next really month or so. And in some ways, it is a swerve from the projects described by Rob Casper in that amazing introduction. Thank you so much. And thanks to the library, of course, for bringing me here. And in some ways, it's a continuation of those projects. So this is a book called The Poem Is You. And as some of you may know, and some of you won't know, that title comes from the end of John Ashbery's wonderful 16-line lyric, Paradoxes and Oxymorons, from 1981. This is a poem that begins, "This poem is concerned with language on a very plain level. Look at it talking to you. You miss it. It misses you. You miss each other. And at the end of the poem has set me softly down beside you. The poem is you." And Ashbery is thinking in that poem about the long and sort of wonderful tradition of lyric poetry that thinks about how lyric poetry speaks to you, poetry that is self-conscious about what poetry is supposed to do in a kind of timeless or anti-historical sense. And one of the things he has in mind is Rainer Maria Rilke's very famous German sonnet, Our Charakterzug of Apollo, which ends, Du musst du Leben ändern, apology if you speak German, I don't, you must change your life. But Ashbery is also trying to think about what his kind of poetry is doing and what the new kinds of poetry can do to speak to the different kinds of people, the different expectations and backgrounds and interests of all of the different yous that are going to constitute, that are going to comprise his audience and the audience of poets to come, and perhaps in particular the audience of near future America, the America of the 80s and 90s and the 21st century. So this is a book of 50 poems, and I picked the poems by 50 poets, and I picked the poets, subject to certain constraints. They had to be American, for instance. I had considered doing a world poetry in English book because there are a lot of poets writing in English right now, from Patience Agbabi to Michelle Leggett, who we should all be reading, who are not in any sense American. And there are poets like Paul Muldoon, who's great, or Ann Carson, or Derek Walcott, who are all quite prominent and deserve to be quite prominent, and have lived in America or live in America but don't consider themselves American. I sort of conferred at the start with the publisher, who's going to be Harvard University Press, about how to do this, and was told, you know, what we need right now is an American book, and maybe there can be a sequel. And if you're in this room, you probably, probably know that Paul Muldoon and Derek Walcott are poets and they're worth reading. I've written about them before. I'll write about them again. They were in a book called The Art of the Sonnet, which was in some ways I didn't know it was that, but a dry run for this, which was 100 sonnets with an essay on each. So this is 50 poems, all written since 1981. By 50 American poets, the most recent, published for the first time in 2014. And the idea is that if you read this book, you won't read all the poets you might like or all the poets who are worth reading. Did someone just buzz the buzzer on me then? Are we having a problem? Am I feeding back? Aha. Yeah. So it's not all the poets you might possibly like, but it's an introduction to a lot of the different kinds of poetry being written or that have recently been written, a lot of the different aesthetics and positions and backgrounds that contemporary American poets can represent. And it's 50 poems that I like very much. And so I'm going to read you parts of and adapted swaths of the introduction in which I hope you can maybe help me think about what this giant thing, this big jigsaw puzzle, this mosaic called contemporary American poetry is, why it's so worth looking at it as a whole and why it's so hard. So I don't know if you have friends who have come here to live or to travel from Quebec City or Brisbane or Nairobi or Kingston or Sao Paulo, but they might have asked you, what should you see when you visit America? Where should you live if you're planning to move? And these questions have a lot of good answers, but there's no single right answer. Should you go hiking in New Hampshire? Should you meet comic book artists in Portland, Oregon? Should you be investigating grassland restorations? And it is important for this analogy and for this book to get outside metropolitan centers and tourist destinations and things that are already as famous as a thing can be. Should you be learning Ojibwe in Minnesota? Should you be surfing in greater LA? Should you be helping organize unions in greater LA? Those are all things that are worth doing. And whether you should come to America and do any one of them or all of them, in addition to seeing the Empire State Building or seeing the National Gallery of Art, it depends on who you are and what your interests are and where you're coming from, right? And contemporary American poetry is, in this sense, an image of America. It is vast. It is fascinating. It can be baffling. You don't always feel at home in it. If you feel at home in one part, you probably won't feel at home in another. If you're visiting Switzerland, you want to see some Alps, right? If you were visiting England in 1596, you probably want to try to take in a Shakespeare play, right? But it seems to me that there's not a contemporary American poet or small body of poetry, not even John Ashbery, with whom this book begins and who seemed to occupy that position to some people at one point. There's no one feature that dominates contemporary American poetry in that way. It has instead this enormous and varied geography whose high points are quite hard to connect. And that's one reason why we organize this book the way that we do. Each essay, like each poem, can stand on its own. And together, these essays tell not one story, but a whole bunch of overlapping stories about the states, plural, of the art singular. I'll get back to that. And each essay is a piece of advocacy. It says, here's a poem. Each essay also gives context for that poem, placing it within the career of an author, within a part of American history or culture, and sometimes within the trajectory of a movement or a school. Who are the language poets? Why are they not just one poet 10 times? How are they different? What was the Chicano Movimiento in the West Coast in the 70s that Juan Felipe Herrera comes out of? And the poem that we chose from him, and that's one of the few essays you can already read. It's on the web and you can Google it. It is about his wonderful poem, Blood on the Wheel. So for poems that might baffle readers who are new to those styles, they ended up just spending a good deal of time decoding and explaining what happens in the poem and how it might make sense. And if it doesn't make consecutive prose sense the way essays and stories make sense, what other kind of sense it makes? Does it make sense the way paintings make sense? Does it make sense the way songs, a punk rock song or a piece of leader or a sort of dance track makes sense? And for poems that seem lucid, poems by people like, for example, Stanley Kunitz, where if you're reading a Kunitz poem, you might have a lot of questions, one of which is, why am I crying at the end? But you're not likely to say, I have no idea what's happening. So writing on people like Stanley Kunitz, I had the obligation and the opportunity to try and explain why it's so moving and how it fits into his career. I got to riff a little bit in the introduction on the different kinds of poems that are available. Really tiny poems, 1 and 2 line poems, like precisely ground lenses made of just a few dozen words. Expansive, chatty, conversational poems about many, many things that maybe haven't been in poems before or haven't been in good ones, from eyeglasses to tide pools to barbecues to beat up antiques or antiqued furniture. There are also corrosive attacks on everyday life under capitalism. There is a revelation of supernatural power among children in a Utah national park. There is, this is the Cunitz poem, A Child's Discovery of Mortality in a Worcester Elementary School. There's a defense of cake decoration bedazzled with curlicued syntax and off rhyme. There is an even more elaborate ode to a commercially doomed prefab house that turns out to double as a critique of the way that the TSA has taken over our airports. There's a poet who records with great equanimity an earthquake in daylight hours in greater LA. And there's a poet, not Robert Frost, who remembers a choppy ride through New England snow in a dream. There is a laconic, almost folkloric retelling of the Christian Annunciation and a cosmopolitan Persian Urdu-derived lyric about exile, atheism, and Moby Dick. And there are poems, this turned out to be a through line, that model themselves on, even if they don't directly describe, various kinds of music. Doo-wop. I should say hi to Jeff Burt, my father, who's in the audience. Hi. Who is or was a doo-wop fan at one point. To romantic and classical composed music, of course. To Osage and Sioux chants and tribal music. To bebop, to blues, to indie rock, and of course to rap. There are mothers, fathers, lovers, friends, painters, marine biologists, soldiers, horses, foresters, goths, teachers, teens, post-Marxist saxophonists, more horses. Horses turned out to be another through line. Beauty contests and beauty contest contestants and beauty contest contestants who plead no contest and walk away from the beauty contest. The author of that poem read here last night, it turns out. If anybody went to see her, you get a cookie. There are self-portraits, epitaphs, palinodes, erotic invitations, sacred allegories, nightmares, avant-garde conundrums, pranks, childhood memories, intricately irregular rhyme, blank verse, free verse of many varieties. Another through line is the many different kinds of free verse, right? When we teach how to read poetry, the textbooks that we have inherited say, here are 10 different kinds of meter and rhyme and form, and then there's this thing called free verse. And most of the interesting poetry being written in America now doesn't rhyme and doesn't have accentual syllabic or other identifiable old meter, but it doesn't mean that the same tools work on it. There are 50 different kinds of free verse, and I ended up explaining the differences between the way Albert Goldbarth's free verse works and Elizabeth Alexander's free verse and Ray Armantrout's free verse. Those are three different kinds of free verse, and they sound different. There are, I hope, if I did this right, 50 poems and 50 styles and 50 reasons to sort of show up. And the essays ended up articulating some of these reasons, and I had the chance to really, I hope it doesn't feel like a trivia contest, but to go outside the poems and explain, for example, the history of Angel Island. Some of you have heard of Angel Island, yeah. Many of you have not because we're on the East Coast, but poetry audience on the West Coast, a lot more people would have heard of it. It is the Ellis Island of a lot of East Asian American immigration, and it was like Ellis Island, but more harshly in some ways, a detention center. One of my favorite books of the last few years with one of my favorite poems in it, thinks about Angel Island a lot. I got to explain some of the fauna and flora of the Florida Gulf Coast, early computer fonts and the beginning of email, and the controversy. If you've just moved to DC, you may not be aware that there was a big controversy over the now sort of widely admired Vietnam Veterans Memorial, the Mai Lin Black Wall. And I also got to explain matters specific to poetry, some of which are old matters. What's a sestina? Some of which are quite new. What have blogs and Twitter and instant messaging done to or for or against the supposedly more durable ways of using language that poems involve? I got to explain things that have been explained repeatedly ad nauseum in academia, but that haven't been publicized in certain ways. Some of these are West Coast things. Why did poets in the 80s, the late 70s and 80s, who wanted to challenge all of your assumptions start using this thing called the new sentence? What was that about? Why do these poems that use the new sentence seem just like word salad on Monday and then open up and make a certain kind of sense the way paintings make sense or the way electronic music makes sense on Tuesday? What's going on there? I really got to stretch deeper into the past, and not just the European past. The ghazal, one of the most important forms, closed forms that American poets have adopted is ultimately a Persian Arabic form, and I got to explain how those things work. This is another one of the few essays from this book that's been released. You can read it. It is about the Aga Shahid Ali Ghazal Tonight, which is the title poem in his book, Call Me Ishmael Tonight. And you probably know where Call Me Ishmael comes from. Yeah. Yeah, so Moby Dick meets the Persian tradition, meets all of Islamic culture, meets actually secularism within Islamic culture, which is a story that Shahid's poetry tells. So there are poets who imagine that their audience includes children, and other poets who are what the terrific poet Douglas Kearney calls dintelligible. That's Kearney's coinage. Dintelligible poetry, and he's speaking specifically of an African-American avant-garde, is poetry where what appears as noise in noise to some, thus insensible but perhaps sensual, is in fact complex contrapuntal signals. That's Kearney. And I also got to think about poems that don't feel like poems at all, because some of the works that we are told to call poems, some of the works that I'm telling you here is a poem, might not look like poems. They might be a block of prose, for example. The most of the poems in the poem as you are poems by anybody's definition. And this is a great range. I hope it's great. It's certainly a range. And I discovered that all of these poems take on at least one of two tasks that are still the tasks best fitted to poetry, as opposed to prose fiction, television, stage plays, comics and graphic novels, or video games. So, what are these two tasks? One, a poem lets us imagine somebody else's inner life, somebody else's interior life and feelings and attitudes and ways of being in the world, almost as if it were or could have been our own. Poems project a voice and embody a compelling or attractive individual consciousness, which we can then hear or speak or sing or try on or try out as if it were our own. And if a poem brings you wisdom about your own life, as many poems from all historical periods do, it also tells you somebody else got there first. So it's this thing that's like a mask or a hat or a dress or a suit that you can try on and say, what's it like to be this person? What if I were they? And that's a very traditional goal. That goal is sometimes given the slightly confusing name of lyric. It's confusing because lyric also means poems that are like songs. And the connection between those two senses of lyric is that a song is something that you can sing, you can give voice to it, you can make it your own. Now, this is a goal that involves contradictions. How can you see yourself in someone else's words without being them? But it's a goal that almost stubbornly persists. And actually, the current U.S. Poet Laureate has written in his sort of wonderful way with many swerves and turns about that goal. This is from his new book, Notes on the Assemblage, it's called, right? In which he imagines, he's talking about portraiture and painting and painted portraits, but he's also talking about poems by extension, in which he says that a poem, like a painted portrait, poses for you when you are at your beginnings, then it follows you, passes you, dissolves ahead of you, where it is waiting for you. When you get there, you will not know it until you see that it is seeing you, seeing you. Poetry gives you a picture that seems to depict the poet, but it also follows you. It gets ahead of you. It stays conscious of you and ends up showing to you some part of yourself. Now, the other poetic goal, I said there were two. The other goal is less traditional, but it's no less important. Poetry, because it uses words in highly patterned ways, because it pays attention to all of the aspects of a word, its history and its sound, not just the aspect that most directly conveys information. Because poetry doesn't have to tell you a story with events in causal order, and doesn't have to tell you how to do your taxes or how to fix a car, or how to get a bill through Congress, fortunately, poetry can make language strange. It can reveal or upend the assumptions or the habits that go without saying when we use language in less unusual ways. The literary theorist Jonathan Culler, who just wrote a terrific academic book called Theory of the Lyric. If you read academic books, check out Jonathan Culler's book, Theory of the Lyric, and if you don't, that's okay. I hope one of my functions in life is to popularize or make accessible ideas in books like the books that he writes. In this book, one of the many ideas he has is that the main function in certain sorts of poem, in certain sorts of poetic language, might be, quote, to signal imaginative strangeness, resistance to ordinary lines of thought. Rather than showing us to ourselves or showing parts of ourselves to ourselves, a poem can shock us or change us by showing us what we don't know. Residents of Austin, Texas. Anyone lived in Austin? Been to Austin? Been to Austin? Yeah. There used to be these t-shirts and bumper stickers that said, "Keep Austin Weird." Yeah, you've seen them. And poems that have this goal might have the same kind of slogan on their t-shirts or their shoelaces. They're trying to keep the world and to keep the language weird, either to keep us alert to the social and political and economic problems that make the world worse than it could be, or just to sharpen our sense of what we hear and what we see. And these goals, showing you what it's like to be you and what you have in common with someone else, and keeping the language weird, making the world weird, defamiliarizing, they seem like opposites. And they're sometimes talked about as opposites, but really they go together all the time within individual poems. And part of the story of this book and part of the story of American poetry now is how often they turn out to go together in practice, those two goals, even though they are opposed in principle. So I mentioned Angel Island poetry. Brandon Somm, the author of the last poem in the book right now, which is a set of quatrains. It is, I think, 36 quatrains, each of which sounds like its sounds are based on a very famous poem by Li Po that was carved or sort of brushed into the walls by Chinese immigrants who were detained at Angel Island. So this is a poem, and the poem is called Où Li Po, which means in French, where is Li Po? But it is also the name of a Paris-based group of late modernist poets and fiction writers who wanted writers to defamiliarize, to make the language strange, to use often mathematical or logical games. The most famous Où Li Po book is probably a novel written without the letter E, called La Disparition in French. It's usually translated into English as a void. So Où Li Po, but also Où Li Po. New head games with literature, but Où Li Po, where is tradition? Where is traditional lyric? And where is traditional lyric? It's on the walls at Angel Island, which is a very important part of American history. So these goals, and really there are three goals. There's making the language strange, there's introducing you lyrically to other people and showing you parts of yourself, and then there's doing the work that cultural historians and often political activists do of showing you what's happened in the society that we live in and the previous iterations of that society that bequeathed to us problems that we're still trying to fix. These are three goals, right? And they can be discussed or distinguished in principle, but they go together in practice in poems like Brendan Somm's and really in most of the poems that are in this book. And each of these poems presents a way of arranging the language and a question about the culture, the part of American culture from which it emerged. And each one, I think, is a separate insight about how we can live in the world. This is a three-part introduction. That was part one. I'll give you some of part two and then stop for questions. And part three, maybe we can ditch. I'm also happy to be interrupted if something didn't make sense or needs clarification. He spoke and drank rapidly a glass of water. So there's no main route, right? There's no main highway that runs through all of the United States. And it turns out there's no main route, there's no single argument that connects all of the American poetry that interests me. But there are a lot of cities on I-95, right? You know, some of the rest you can get to by I-5 or I-90 or I-70. And in the same way, there are concerns, there are goals, there are stories about American poetry that can connect a lot of these poems. And part of the work of an introduction to a book like this is to tell some of those stories, to outline some of those routes. Are you ready? During the late 60s and 70s, a lot of American poets, maybe most of them, wrote free verse that could be paraphrased and that made prose sense and that portrayed events in the poet's own lives. And these events could be enlightening moments of beauty or encounters with non-human nature. In the tradition of, for example, William Wordsworth, they could also be traumatic moments of shame or stress in a poet's biography, in a tradition we sometimes call confessional. Like John Berryman and Anne Sexton and Robert Lowell. As American culture in those years grew more overtly political and more hospitable to expressions of radical politics, as more and more writers felt stirred or obliged to speak out for racial justice and against the Vietnam War, poets took part in that speech. And already eminent mid-career poets, this is the late 60s and 70s, who were not otherwise similar at all, from Adrian Rich to W.S. Merwin to Amiri Baraka, registered in their work of the 60s and 70s both a pressure towards clarity, for the sake of political efficacy, and a revulsion from familiar and clearly elaborately organized and European-derived, which maybe meant them, made them sort of guilty, forms. So a lot of that poetry tries to be as unmediated, as visceral, and as uncomplicated as it is possible for emotion-laden language to be. And this goal fit both the introspective poets like Merwin, who is in the same poems trying to sort of say the war in Vietnam is terrible and car culture is terrible, and the sort of retreat from public engagement and to be this very inward person, and poets who really want to be part of a movement, who are outspoken, like Amiri Baraka. And influential anthologies from this period had titles that made clear these poets' goals, like Naked Poetry and No More Masks. And this trend, which as it expanded, also became about other clear social and cultural goals, feminism, for example, in many of its varieties, this trend, like all trends in the arts, laid the grounds for its own antithesis. Now, there were poets who had begun writing in the 40s and 50s who wrote in densely patterned, European-derived, traditional closed forms and just never stopped. Some of those poets wanted the U.S. out of Vietnam and wanted queer liberation just as much as did poets who were writing in sort of instinctive, simplified free verse. But they didn't change their forms. But there were other poets, often poets who'd never felt any connection to these much older forms, who wanted to get away from the sort of sense of clarity and purpose and transparency and intuitiveness of 70s mainstream free verse poetry. And some of these poets were looking to the New York School poets, looking to people like John Ashbery, who had already come up with a very slippery, challenging style derived in turn from French and Russian modernism and from painting. And there were other poets, especially in New York, DC, and on the West Coast, who turned into what we now call the language writers, who made a very challenging style that was as far from prose sense as you can be. At the same time, in the 70s, as some of you know, there were various ethnic liberation movements that tried to come up with styles whose roots were in the cultural group, the ethnic group, that the poets were trying to liberate. The Black Arts Movement is the most famous such. What's going on out there? Yeah. So the Black Arts Movement is the most famous such group. But for almost every important demographic that you can think of, you can find poetry written by members of that group from the 70s, which tries to find a distinctive way of writing proper to that group's emancipatory goals. So now we're in the 80s. And if you're coming of age as a poet in the 80s, you have to handle all of that stuff that's already happened. You have to negotiate your relationship to the modernism of Gertrude Stein and the modernism of T.S. Eliot. You have to negotiate your relation to poets against the war, to the sort of intuitive styles that dominated American poetry in the 70s. If you are on the West Coast, at least, you have to figure out whether you care about the language poets and their challenges to all prose sense. If you are an African-American poet, you are being asked how you feel about the Black Arts Movement, whether you want to be asked or not. And pretty much all of the poets I can think of whose careers begin in the 80s have poems where they figure, who are black poets, who figure out, they have to figure out where they stand in relation to that very powerful tradition and counter tradition. Rita Dove has a poem called On Seeing Don L. Lee in a Dream, in which she says to the black arts movement at that point in her career, thanks but no thanks. Other poets have more complicated responses. And I talk about that. Other things that happened in the 80s that the poets I'm writing about sort of have to either step away from deliberately or respond to are the institutional growth of creative writing programs. Do you respond in your poetry to your institution, to your mentor? This is more complicated than people who notice it often think, because some of the most widely imitated poets of the 80s and 90s are not people who are institutionally powerful, who are teaching in big creative writing programs. James Merrill and John Ashbery. Ashbery teaches creative writing, but he doesn't have a sort of gaggle of students around him who are there because someone's paying their tuition. A.R. Ammons is almost impossible to imitate, weirdly. But he's teaching in the graduate creative writing program at Cornell, and you can sort of find his students' places. Who gets imitated is not necessary. Who's influential as a matter of style does not map on to who has institutional power. But poets are aware of these institutions. And I have a couple of poems in this book that are quite aware of the classroom and the university as a place of instruction and a place of constraint. So when you look at accounts of the 80s and 90s that were written then, they sort the poets into schools. They say, here are the new formalists, here are the neo-confessionals, here is a free verse mainstream, here are the New Eurekan poets. If you're interested in that stuff, please go read a book by Urayo and Noel called Invisible Movement, which is a terrifically readable scholarly history of the New Eurekans, of what we think of as spoken word poetry before that was a term. And it's quite intellectually rich. There is New Eurekan poetry in this book. It turned out to be hard for me to write about, because I don't normally write about stage plays and spoken word artists. But you can't represent American poetry without acknowledging that. So people who write about this stuff in the 80s and 90s talk about schools and groups and movements. In the same way, and I think I'm going to wrap up soon to have question time, in the same way that if you're talking about groups of cities, groups of American places, you might want to talk about regions and highways, right? What is Texas, right? What is the Gulf Coast? What is New England? What is Northern New England? And you have to do that to introduce poets. I ended up doing that. But doing that obscures as much as it reveals, because it's not true that you can experience the Florida Gulf Coast equally well by going to any town or city or hamlet along it, right? You may want to see the Southwest, but it matters whether you go to Santa Fe or Albuquerque or Las Cruces or Taos or what. And it matters on what side of Santa Fe you are, if you've been there. It matters a lot. One of the reasons that I like trying to introduce American poetry in this way is that I get to describe specific locations, specific places, as it were, specific almost houses and buildings you can stay in to extend this analogy, and at the very least, specific towns and villages and cities, rather than having to describe things in terms of generality, because any poem worth reading is going to do things that no other poem can do. You do have to know where it comes from to get the full measure of what it's trying to do, but then you have to see what makes it different, what makes it distinct, what makes it memorable. I did not end up memorizing every single one of these 50 poems. I ended up knowing a few of the short ones from memory. I don't quite have that kind of brain. I think I never did. But I felt like I was coming close. And as it came close to knowing parts of poems from memory as I was writing about them, I realized how different they were from the kinds of poems they would normally be taken to be. And the most fun part of this was coming to poems and seeing how each one was unique, what each one did with its conjunction of region and style and ethnic heritage and sort of affect and sound pattern, what each one did that no other poem did. And the end of part two as it were, talks a little bit about what's changed since 2000. What groupings of poems and what attitudes towards poems critics ought to take and have felt obliged to take and poets themselves have taken that were not 80s and 90s attitudes, and that emerged as I was selecting, which proved easier in some ways, poems from the time when I've been a practicing critic. And should I say in a few minutes what's happening recently on the large scale? The pattern in the poetry of the aughties that didn't show up during the time when Rob, for example, began publishing poetry, right? The time when I started writing was when sort of Rob started publishing and people of my generation started publishing, was the 90s, which was a time of synthesis to some extent. Let's try and bring these schools together. And that's continued. But what happened in the aughties? Well, some planes hit some buildings. After some planes hit some buildings, a whole lot of people who were members of the US military and some who were not went into a whole lot of countries very far away, and they've stayed there for a while. And then a few years after that, a very large hurricane put a lot of an American city underwater. And one of the patterns from the aughties that is not a pattern from the 90s is poems in reaction to major public events. And it turns out, I still don't know actually, one of the reasons I can't give out a table of contents is that I haven't, not all of the 50 poems have been selected. And nobody wants to be the last one in or the first one out. If you follow college basketball, you know, right? We can talk about this year's women's bracket if you want afterwards. I don't know how many UConn fans there are here, but you don't want to know that you're the last one in or the first one out, and that's a matter that is up to me primarily, but it is something publishers have a hand in. But I will say, without telling you what poem, that it looks like we want to say something about the very large body of Hurricane Katrina poems. Hurricane Katrina had a much larger impact on American poetry than, honestly, than September 11th or the military conflict in Afghanistan or Iraq. More American poets wrote more poems and more memorable poems about it. There were a lot of poems that respond to September 11th, and there are some good ones. I recommend Don Revell's, for example. But they often do so obliquely or indirectly, or about they're sort of watching what's going on there from a distance. And that's because there was a flood of debased public language, saying very simplified things immediately. And it's because the causes and the solutions to the problems that created Al-Qaeda are not problems that most American poets who are intellectually responsible can feel that they understand. To really be able to write with mastery about the situation that allowed some bad guys, I will call them bad guys, to set up camps in Afghanistan in the late 90s, you should probably read Arabic and speak some Pashtun, right? You should know something about the history of the Middle East. You should know something about the longer tradition of Islamic culture and civilization so that you can say, you know, these guys were really not that, and that's great. And there are American poets now, actually, who are doing that. But most people who were publishing books of poetry in American English in 2001 and 2002 were not competent to do that, nor were they competent to make defense policy. Hurricane Katrina, on the other hand, was nature plus the US government within the United States. And a lot of people have roots in New Orleans, people who vary in other ways, who consider themselves white or black or both or neither, who are French speakers, who are not French speakers. A lot more American poets have been to New Orleans, right? Raise your hand if you've been to New Orleans, right? Raise your hand if you've been to, I'm sure there are veterans in the audience, raise your hand if you have been voluntarily to current theaters of war. No, you don't have to raise your hand, but you see the point. Okay, great. But there are a lot of reasons, and I sort of realized this as I was putting this together, why there are so many more American poems and many, many good American books, a double handful of books worth reading that are really Katrina books. There are now several worthwhile books by veterans of the war in Iraq, but there are still more Katrina books. And those books by veterans only began to appear after the veterans came home. Brian Turner is the best known. So public events, right? The other story of the Audis is self-identified avant-garde schools that made a lot of noise. One school called Conceptualism, which I think might be over, and one school called Flarf, which actually interests me a little more. And these schools were at war with each other and with what they called the mainstream of American poetry for a while, and they made a lot of noise. But what's going on now? I actually would say that we are in the post-Citizen world, that the publication of Claudia Rankine's book Citizen, which is a New York Times bestseller, which for most of its length doesn't look like poetry, most of its prose poems, a couple different kinds of prose poems, partly it's an artist's book, it's got visual art, it's got scripts for videos, it's also got very accomplished verse. It is a book that says in and of itself, and that said by virtue of its reception, which was coextensive with, on the one hand, the Black Lives Matter stuff that's still going on, I think Minneapolis today, the sort of interest by people who aren't necessarily engaged in poetry in race and police and social justice and what do we have a government for? Certainly it's not to just beat people up. That on the one hand, and then on the other hand, a lot of smaller scale, in some cases they seem petty, they're gonna seem petty in 10 years, but they're also emblematic of very, very deep and important divisions in terms of how poets are socialized and how the institutions of poetry works. Controversy around, for example, a poet who used a Chinese name but is in no way Chinese or Chinese American in this year's Best American Poetry volume, which is a very good volume, I think. Controversies around institutions of poetry like the Associated Writers Programs, which you don't need to care about, but I need to care about, which are all ancillary to and sort of illuminate the difference that Citizen has made. And the difference that Citizen has made, the way the poetry world, if you're sort of in it, feels really different now than it did in 2012, are that things that don't look like poetry are normal, even if you're not from the avant-garde, and that if you are from a majority group, you are expected to think about your position of privilege by poetry, even if you can't do so in your own poetry. One of the interesting things about putting this book together is that there are a number of poets, I'm certain that she's in this volume, so I can name it, Gabby Bess, who was a tremendously interesting poet of the internet generation, who I'm pretty sure identifies as African American. You wouldn't know it from reading this poem. Should I say, by the way, this is an African American person in the essay when it doesn't seem to impinge? I don't know. John Yao, who is also certainly in it, I'm putting in a wonderful John Yao sestina. If you know John Yao's work, you know that some of it's about being Chinese American and some of it not. This poem you wouldn't know just from reading it, but it engages issues that are central to thinking about Asian American identity and that are central to John Yao's critics, and so I do discuss ethnicity in there. But this is a byway, bringing us back to what does it mean that we're in the post-Citizen world. It means that I am asking, and I hope that my readers would ask me, if I say, why didn't you do this, if I didn't do this, every time you have a poem by a white poet, should you say, by the way, this person is white? Here's how this poem engages whiteness, which are questions that classrooms ask about poets who are members of identifiable minorities. We should be asking those questions just as often about white poets. During the time that I was sort of putting this together, I also, I have two genders, sometimes I wear dresses. This is a formal event where I'm talking about poetry that I didn't write, so I'm dressed in a way that I hope is appropriate to literary critics at the Library of Congress. When I'm talking about my own poetry, sometimes I look a little different. And I now get asked, is this about gender, is this about gender, is this about gender, because I am a member of an identifiable minority. These are questions that should be coming up with every poem. How is this poem engaged with, or is it interested in the position either of being singled out or the position of privilege, the unmarked position — unmarked is a very important word here — that the poet is in. And the post-Citizen world that we live in as readers and critics of contemporary poetry is a world that, not acting alone, Claudia Rankine didn't come from the moon, as she has written previous books. Do go read Don't Let Me Be Lonely. That book, partly because it's so good and so different, and partly because of the reception it's had, and partly because of the moment it happened to arrive at, has meant that part of the normal activity of poetry criticism is saying, what position does this poem reflect? How does it reflect on the marked or the unmarked status of the speaker whom we imagine or the author whom we imagine behind it? I hope I've done a good job of reflecting on that without making this solely a book, because it can't be a book, about demographics or privilege or power. Diversity in this book means census categories. It means demographics. But this is not a book of human beings, it's a book of 50 poems. So diversity also means long lines, short lines, difficult poems, apparently easy poems, long poems, short poems, poems that have lots of internal rhyme, poems that assiduously avoid it, poems that come from California, poems that come from Minnesota, poems that come from South Carolina, poems that come from the metropolitan center, places like New York or DC or the Bay Area, poems that really don't, poems of rural life, poems in pentameter, funny poems, sad poems. Those are kinds of diversity too. And I really hope I've done justice to them. And I hope it's a fun book as well as an enlightening book, as it sort of lets you make your way around the America that these poems produce.
Thank you, Steve. I just wanted to take the opportunity to ask the first question, but I just wondered, as you were finishing that talk, you brought up this notion of what's happening now with the poets and understanding where they're coming from. How do you handle that in your response to these 50 poems in your own voice as a critic? And how do you negotiate that kind of understanding of what you bring to bear to that criticism with your role as a gatekeeper in a book like this?
I want to be sure I answer the question you asked and not the question you didn't ask. I wouldn't be surprised if this ended up having 54 poems instead of 50. Some of that has to do with page count and permissions. Ask me about permissions. It's actually easier than I thought it would be, but I thought it would be awful. There's a certain amount of slots, right? There's a certain amount of goodies to give out. And I think you were asking about putting this book together rather than about the other stuff that I do. Or were you asking putting this book together? The printed introduction talks about how I did this at some length. And the important thing to keep in mind, if you are ever in this position yourself, which some of you may be, is that you're not picking the 50 best poems and leaving number 51 out. So you know, this is not, in fact, the college basketball bracket. You're not even doing what the college basketball bracket, in fact, does, which is to pick the best of a certain number of categories and then the best of the rest. Apologies if you do not follow men's or women's college basketball, but if you win each conference, if you win the Sun Belt Conference or you win the Big South Conference, you get into the tournament. And then the NCAA people fill the bracket with the conference winners, and then all the rest of the slots go to teams that seem really good, but that didn't win an individual conference. And the wrong way to make this anthology, the wrong way would be to do it that way, to say, okay, we need a rural poet, we need an Asian American poet, we need a poet who writes in rhyme forms, we need the best of each of these discrete, figured out in advance categories, that sort of champions of each conference, and then we're gonna fill the rest of the slots with the best ones until we get, we cross off our list of best ones until we get to 50. Because you can't do that with poetry. There isn't really a 17th best poem in America, right? There's not really a 17th best basketball team, but at least you can argue about that. It's ridiculous to think there's a 17th best poet. The right way to think about this stuff for me has been, this is like having a dinner party or serving a meal to a dinner party or creating a team of superheroes. If you've already got three people who can punch really well, maybe you want someone who can walk through walls. If you've already got someone who can walk through walls, maybe you want someone who can set things on fire.
if you've already got, you know, two firepowers people, maybe you want someone who can speak every language, which is a real superhero, by the way, ask me later. In other words, you don't just want poems that are awesome in themselves, because there are a lot more than 50 poems I like. You want poems that will complement one another in order to make the experience of the whole thing as welcoming as possible, as interesting as possible, as memorable as possible, for as large as possible a slice of the people you think might be reading your book. So that does mean, at least it meant for me, coming up with a short list of poets and of kinds of poems, which sometimes meant kinds of people, who I could not leave out. I wasn't going to do a book that didn't have John Ashbery. I wasn't going to do a book that did not have Louise Glück. I wasn't going to do a book that did not have any poems about the experience of disability. I wasn't going to do a book that didn't have any love poems. It turns out we have at least one love poem about the experience of disability. I think I categorize it that way, yeah. So, you know, some superheroes have multiple powers, right? Some things are both a fruit and a vegetable if you're making dinner. But the point is that this is trying to put together a set of poems that work well together. And it means ultimately fretting over who and what I have left out. But it also means remembering that there's no such thing as picking the 50 best or the 25 best, and that the idea is to create an ensemble. Does that answer your question? I mean, it's fun putting things in, but the hard part is, actually the hard sad part is what to leave out. The hard fun part is realizing there are sectors of American poetry and sectors of America that I have never written about, and then discovering them and going through them and saying, if I really think I need to investigate this in order to have this be a good book, what am I going to find? And I've found poems and poets that I really would not have found had I not taken this project on, who I really like.
Talk a little bit. I mean, one of the things that's changed recently is the internet, social media sort of compositional method. People like Patricia Malkin and Monique Joke, which is bypass the usual distribution system.
That's a great poem.
Yeah.
So there's two. You just asked about two different things. Thank you for the question. They're related, but they're not the same. One is, how does social media change, and just beyond, when you say social media, you're talking Twitter and Facebook and Pinterest and Instagram, but social media and the web more generally change access and distribution for poems. And the other is, how do social media and the internet in general change the kinds of poems that can be written? And Patricia Lockwood, who's great, I actually don't know if she's in this book. I've written about her, she's wonderful, I hope to write about her again, I've taught her books. If she's not in this, she'll be one of the people I'm sad to leave out. But so Patricia Lockwood, if you don't know, is someone who has like a couple million followers on Twitter. At Patricia Lockwood, I'm one of them. And she tweets these things that she sometimes calls sexts. And they're not actually sort of texts of people saying let's have sex. They are off-color or NC-17 jokes of one or another kind that also touch on serious matters. Patricia Lockwood also writes poetry that doesn't sound like her sexts. She writes poetry that is in often a post-surrealist tradition. Her first book was published by Octopus Books, which is very much a post-surrealist enterprise. I think, Rob, you know some of those people. She writes, she's more recently written poems that are more accessible and I think better, but that are also very, very strange and don't sound like her tweets. One of which is an amazing poem, it's a prose poem called Rape Joke. It is about four pages long, is a series of short prose blocks about her experience of having been sexually assaulted and about her reaction to that experience. She has said in interviews, the point of her of my poem Rape Joke, I'm trying to stay close to her words, the point of my poem Rape Joke is that if you've been raped, you don't have to talk about it, but you don't have to write about it, but if you do write about it, you can write about it any way you want. It is a poem that is not only, I think, a good poem, but has done real liberatory social work. It's actually helped a lot of people who could use some help in a way that very few American poets have the chance to do. And that's because it circulated widely, widely, widely on social media once it was published on a wonderful magazine called The Awl, thanks to poetry editor Mark Bibbins. But Rape Joke could have been written without social media. If it has any connection to social media stylistically or thematically, it's a very tenuous connection of now we feel free to say more things online because we have less privacy. It is a prose poem about the weird interactions of sexual humor and patriarchy and having been assaulted. So Patricia Lockwood became so popular because she wrote a great poem that circulated and people emailed it to each other and retweeted it. And she also tweets, which helped people retweet it. But her style has not been informed as a poet by new electronic media. Other poets' styles have. Some of those poets are people who you actually need a digital platform to read the poem. Right? Nick Montfort, who writes sort of computer programming code poems. You can't, Nick's best work, you actually have to be in front of a computer to see what it's doing, or you have to be able to sort of read code the way people read orchestra score. So no, Nick Montfort is not in here because his current projects cannot work on dead trees unless you read code. Or the sort of best parts of them can't. We do have probably two poets, one of whom is quite young, actually. I mentioned Gabby Bess, whose practice as a poet has been shaped by all lit and by sort of non-institutional new means of transmission, sort of. People who read Rookie Magazine teach each other to write when they turn 20, and some of them are actually quite good by then already. This very anti-institutional stylistic formation that is totally impossible without social media. But that's different from Rape Joke. Is that?
Yes.
Okay.
Hi. In everything you've talked about, the diversity in collecting the poems for your book, and also the comments and questions regarding poetry on social media.
Mm-hmm.
I'm wondering how important is the difference between the oral tradition versus the written poet?
Yeah, that's a couple of questions at once, and thanks for asking all of them. The oral tradition can mean the memorization of poetry and the process of valuing the poem because it can be memorized and recited and passed on that way. Sort of thing that Robert Pinsky quite rightly recommends, which includes, for example, Robert Frost. The oral tradition can also mean forms of composition and ways of sharing poetry that are about live social practice, about a poem being recited at powwows and Native American events, or a poem that sort of draws on sort of spoken word culture, on Native American stuff. For example, or on, again, this is sort of things that very young people are doing, sort of consciousness-raising events, where you sort of snap if you like the poem. Those are oral traditions, too. They're not the same as one another. They are not the same as memorizing a poem by Robert Frost, so you can pass them on and learn that kind of memorizability. And they are not the same, again, as oral formulaic composition, which is how we got the Iliad and the Odyssey. And which is a way of making poems designed for cultures which don't have writing, and which has traces, actually, in certain kinds of contemporary American poetic practice. John Miles Foley, the classicist who died recently, wrote a terrific book called How to Read an Oral Poem about this, in which John Miles Foley writes about Homer and South Slavic epic, which is composed or was composed in a Homeric way, and about rappers. And it turns out that freestyle rappers in rap battles have a lot more in common with Homer than either of them has in common with, who's a good example, Marianne Moore. who, by the way, another 21st century thing, Marianne Moore does not look like a major influence on American poetry in 1993. She does now. She really does now, and that's awesome. And of all of the things in here that I write about as a critic, the one thing going on now where I feel like when I'm writing poems that are by me, I really feel close to that, is the Marianne Moore revival. Does that answer your question or not? Like, there's one more answer I didn't give, which I can also give if you want. Okay. Okay.
So it's still, the oral tradition is still alive.
The oral traditions, plural. Several oral traditions are still alive, although some have died. Right? People aren't actually composing oral formulaic epic in ancient Greek. I think. Hi.
Could you talk a little bit, I mean, I've been hearing you and appreciating the insights you've given about the portrait you're trying to create, but could you talk a little bit about the nature of the commission that was given to you? Because I still haven't figured out what need or gap is being filled by having this book come out at this particular point in time. What was the nature of the commission you got?
Need is a bit strong, right? The poetry will continue if I never write another word. People will keep on writing and reading poems. I would like them to read and enjoy the poetry that I read and enjoy. I co-wrote a book called The Art of the Sonnet. It came out 4.5 years ago. The way this book came about is from what I can reconstruct. Should I go back this far? I think I won't go back this far. Harvard University Press, in its infinite wisdom, decided it would be a good idea to have a book called The Art of the Sonnet, with 100 sonnets and an essay about each one. And my editor at Harvard University Press, John Kalka, who's great, contacted me something like 7 years ago and said, would you like to write half of this book? David Mickens will write the other half. And I said, do I have to write about Shakespeare's sonnets? Because there's already a book with an essay about each one of Shakespeare's sonnets, and I'm not going to do any better than those essays. I want someone else to do Shakespeare. And John said, yes, David will write about Shakespeare. He's very happy doing that. And then I said, yes. And I got to write 50 essays on sonnets by Sidney and Spencer and Hopkins and Dean Powell and James K. Baxter, the great national poet of New Zealand, and Michelle Leggett and Rita Dove, actually, and a whole bunch of other people. And that was a lot of fun. And this book, I don't have the sales figures. It didn't set the sales world on fire, but apparently it sold well enough that Harvard University Press thinks that there is a market for collections of end poems with one essay about each individual poem that I wrote. And John and I sort of realized we could do this again and make it just contemporary. And make it a way of explaining poem by poem how to read some of what's going on now, and that need is too strong, but there might be a want among readers and maybe among teachers. Because normally, contemporary poetry comes to you in a creative writing classroom in the form of an anthology or 300 photocopied pages. And how you read these new poems is a matter of sort of lore. And you might learn to read one kind of poem because it doesn't seem that hard, because it's just out there, and it's not that different from prose. And you might learn to read another kind of poem if you happen to hang out with the avant-garde. Who's a good example? You take Joshua Clover's classes at the University of California system, and he tells you how all of these poets are undermining capitalism through destroying prose sense. And then you learn how to read poets who are undermining capitalism through destroying prose sense, but you still don't know how to read Robin Schiff or Alan Peterson. For that matter, Mark Strand. So it seemed to me that there's a need or a want or a use for a book that's a bunch of poems and an essay about how to read each one, one that is an introduction, and that's an introduction to multiple ways of writing. I think James Merrill's great. I think Ray Armantrout is great. Most of my friends in the poetry world really enjoy one or the other. And if I was going to have a book that might be, you know, used in classes and bought by people who aren't sort of already professionals, if there's going to be a book that said James Merrill's great, here's how to read him, and a book that said Ray Armantrout's great, here's how to read her, with examples, I probably, you know, maybe I'm one of the people who could write it. So Here it is. My father has a question.
But if I'm a poet, and I know that down the road, my readers are going to read my poem with an essay by someone like you about what I was trying to say, wouldn't that distort the exercise? Put another way, isn't there something wrong with a poem where you have to read an essay to understand the poem?
Since my dad asked the question, I know something about his reading habits. Yes, you were a lawyer. You're also someone with some commitment at some level to Talmud study, right?
Okay, more recently, yes.
So one answer is that interpretation can be pleasurable and edifying in itself. Another answer is that a work of literary art, a piece of writing, can seem to matter or can have consequences for someone who feels removed in time or space or culture from that piece of writing. So I may write a poem that, because it's what I want to write, and I'm really writing for a primary audience of people who are demographically like me, would like you to recognize in a Tavarina stanza and sort of know who the X-Men are, and understand that if you're running for public office, you might want to get people to make cold calls, phone calls for you. I would like it to be read by people who know all those things. I'd also like it to be read by people who don't. And one of the jobs that you have as a critic is just explaining things in order to help the poem reach more people if you like it enough. And that means explaining non-literary contexts, like who are the X-Men and what is a cold call. I just made up, none of my poems have cold calling and the X-Men yet. Yeah. It means explaining these non-literary things, right? Which isn't going to change what poets write. It also means explaining literary things. Where does this form come from? What is the heritage behind this? And it also means, if you can, trying to introduce a reader to the psyche, to the emotion, to the affect that's inside the poem, that's behind the poem. And honestly, I don't think poets write poems in order to be read by a specific audience that the poems are good. I think poets write the poems that they have to write. And I think that introducing a reader to a poem is a lot like introducing a reader to a person. And you don't stop being people because you require an introduction to some of the other people you might like to meet. I really think the longer I do this kind of critical work, that introducing people to poems is a lot like introducing people to people. I don't know if that's a good enough answer.
Great, it wasn't a plan.
I think Yeah,
I was just gonna ask, having written this many essays in pretty contained time frame, how do you think that has or will affect your own writing? I mean, this kind of both how a manual how-to plus celebration of each of these poems has to in some way form your own writing. Maybe you can't tell yet. I'm just wondering if you have any insight into that.
Well, I mean, it is my own writing. I think you mean my writing of poetry.
Yeah,
That's a good question. I sort of can't tell yet. It's actually made me, stylistically, it's made me feel okay about not incorporating into my own writing styles that are distant from me, even though I like them. Thematically, it's sort of had the opposite of effect. The body of poetry that I have written that is poetry by me is really, it's very light, right? The influences and the allusions and the cultural forms in books of poems that I wrote are much whiter than the body of allusions I recognize, the group of imaginative writers that I read, the group of people I write about as a critic. I don't know what to do about that. As a critic of contemporary work, you are responsible to readership and to institutions to try not to perpetuate inequity and to try to be open and fair. As a writer, though, you sort of write what you can write. So it has changed my attitude toward my own work, but it hasn't prevented a little, a little, but it hasn't prevented me from writing. Because with writing criticism trades off for me with writing other criticism. Right, I'm writing fewer scholarly articles this year because I'm finishing this book. Oh well. Writing poetry trades off with childcare stuff and fun stuff that isn't. There, I haven't experienced a time trade-off, but I have experienced a little bit of a change in my attitude toward my own work because I see the ways in which all of my own poetry is kind of narrow, and maybe that's just what I can do and what I can't do, but it has made me more conscious of that. Does that?
Yeah, that's not exactly.
Okay.
I think we're going to take that
thank
moment
you.
To stop.
Thank you.
Steve's critic work and poetry is for sale. On the back, please. Buy his book, have him sign. Also, please fill out our surveys and come back to future Poetry and Literature Center events. Thanks so much for coming out today.
Thank you.
This has been a presentation of the Library of Congress. Visit us at loc.gov.